Welcome to SAP Value Stream Mapping. This is a course from Big Bytes Factory Optimization. Most everybody dealing with the design and execution of production systems knows value stream mapping. It's a proven method for the optimization and promotion of flow of material and information on the shop floor. Value stream mapping has been around for a long time, primarily used by lean practitioners to reduce waste and therefore gain productivity. Big Byte has taken value stream mapping a step further. Adding SAP-specific settings to the map allows us to visualize a production model and concurrently document how the SAP system must be set up to support it. We have achieved great results with SAP value stream mapping, as it provides standardization and serves a learning tool at the same time. Some people shy away from it, however, because the level of effort to create an SAP value stream map can be quite substantial. As with the definition and maintenance of basic data, an SAP VSM brings with it great time savings and efficiency increases later down the road. Everyone must decide for themselves whether an increased upfront effort is worth the savings and benefits that come later. Value stream mapping, also known as material and information flow mapping, is a lean management method for analyzing the current state and designing a future state for the series of events that take a product or service from the beginning of the specific process until it reaches the customer. A value stream map is a visual tool that displays all critical steps in a specific process and quantifies easily the time and volume taken at each stage. Value stream maps show the flow of both materials and information as they progress through the process. The difference between a value stream and a value chain is that a value stream focuses only on areas of a firm that add value to a product or service, whereas a value chain refers to all of the activities within a company. SAP value stream mapping follows the same principles and conventions that traditional value stream mapping does. Additionally, it adds SAP-specific data and settings. On an SAP value stream map, you can document lot sizing procedures and MRP type from the material master, work center category and capacity related information from work centers, identify production versions and routings to be used, define operation data from the routing with its cycle times, and much, much more. A finished SAP value stream map can serve as a complete documentation for a system architect to set up all the functions, features, and customizing settings, in order to run the value stream repetitively and effectively with SAP. Additionally to traditional value stream mapping, SAP value stream mapping adds pragmatism to the design process and allows for the immediate realization of the theoretical design. Let's get into the details of SAP value stream mapping. First, you design the inventory points. These also serve as decoupling points, as we will see later on. An inventory point is defined in SAP as a material master record. Without a material master record, you cannot post a goods receipt of material into stock, and therefore, without a material master in SAP, there is no inventory in SAP. A stock or inventory point in a value stream map is identified with a triangle and a capital I in it. Here we add two boxes with data to the triangle, in order to maintain SAP-specific inventory and master data. In this example, we see the detail of two stock points. First, the end of the flow or routing of the machined forging, and second, when the forging comes back from heat treatment. For both, a material master record must exist in SAP. In the blue box, you can document various settings in the material master record, like the lot sizing procedure, MRP type and safety buffer strategy. The yellow box can then show predicted or anticipated results. What do we currently hold in inventory? How much is the potential reduction? Is there dead stock? What service level should we set? And what buffering strategies must we define? All of this, and more, can be documented on the map. But inventory points must not be traditional stock alone. It can also be a supermarket, as used in lean projects. If the flow is set up as a self-organizing system, as in the case of Kanban or Conwup, then we need a supermarket, from which an order can pull. Notice the icon for supermarket is a different one than the traditional stock point. However, the boxes below are the same. Except that here, you may maintain control cycle data additionally to the material master data. Then we'll design the material flow along work centers or machines. Notice that the flow happens between two inventory points. Eventually this flow will be described by a routing and then used in a production order. From upstream, the left side of the flow, raw materials or semi-finished product is issued and consumed to the order, and the downstream inventory point will receive the finished product from the order. Along the routing there are work centers and the activities, or operations which are executed on those work centers. Each work center where activities take place, has its own data. The work center box contains a description of the work center, and the work center's SAP identification code. The blue box underneath the identification code contains performance data of the work center. Then there are the work center specific data settings like the work center category, standard value key, and the scheduling formulas, amongst other things, in the gray box. Lastly, you can identify what type of capacity may be used on that specific work center. Is it a labor capacity? A machine capacity? Or both? The capacity itself then, is also described by the respective data box. Back to the overview. We can see that each work center is assigned a set of activities that are performed on that work center. These activities contain cycle times and are eventually sequenced into a routing. The routing is usually connected with FIFO lanes, but that does not have to be the case. In this example, we can construct an SAP routing with 7 work centers, and multiple activities executed on each work center. All the necessary information is documented, and any analyst can now set up the system for the planners to use. The routing ends up in the next inventory point, which happens to be a supermarket for the downstream order. Looking at the complete SAP value stream map, we can obtain multiple conclusions, and make various decisions on the future state of our production planning and scheduling system. For one, the decoupling points can be set. Decoupling points are set along the routings. These must be carefully evaluated and possibly rearranged. Here is where the greatest leverage for opportunities and efficiency increases is available. A productive team of analysts will achieve great results here, as changes in routings and placements of decoupling points can be simulated and rated and prioritized for their biggest gain. Be careful though, as there is a fine balance between too few or too many decoupling points, and efficiencies are quickly lost when you miss to foresee unintended consequences and undesired effects. As we discussed before, the inventory points may be a traditional stock point, or a supermarket, depending on the scheduling system you want to define. However, this should make no difference for the flow. They're both decoupling points, and therefore there are inventory transactions to be executed at the beginning and the end of the orders. Remember, decoupling points are defining the start and end of a production orders. And so the flow goes on. From decoupling point to decoupling point, connected through the routings or work orders. What is crucial to consider here, is the difference between inventory and work in process. Work in process, or WIP, is the value of labor and material on the orders, at any given point in time. Inventory, on the other hand, is the value of semi-finished or finished goods that lies on an inventory point. In SAP, it has been received from the previous order, that was flowing into that inventory point. So when and where do we place decoupling points? It's best to define rules for the setting of decoupling points. Then everybody in the organization adheres to the same standards. Here is an example of a rule set for the setting of a decoupling or inventory point. In this case we say that if the first operation of a routing is executed at an external supplier, then we set a decoupling point and accumulate the inventory of that part in-house. Is that not the case, but there is a large imbalance of cycle times, then we have no choice than to decouple. Large imbalances of cycle times from one work center to the next would result in very large waiting times or waste. So if the routing is fairly balanced, then we take a look at the bottleneck work center on that routing. Do we find that the bottleneck is always starving, we can solve the problem by the placement of a decoupling point, which feeds the bottleneck. And finally, if a route contains multiple operations carried out off-site, it might make more sense to hold inventory, as to not interrupt the flow. In any case, when you carry out the SAP value stream mapping exercise, pay careful attention to where you set the inventory points. Spending appropriate time defining a sound SAP value stream map will pay off later down the road, when your planners will need to figure out effective and productive schedules. This concludes the course on SAP value stream mapping. We hope you have enjoyed it. Contact us at BigByte with any questions you might have.